Here's the basic idea. Two lines are not quite parallel. They're separated by two different sized circles. At one end, we have the largest possible diameter for a marble, and at the other, the smallest. Any marble that rolls along these rails will naturally find its appropriate spot in between the two extremities, and it sorts itself out. It falls through.
So why would you want to sort marbles into specific sizes? I don't know. Maybe you're working on a marble machine, or a marble-based game, or a puzzle, or a bearing, or some other mechanical apparatus that requires a tighter tolerance for size than what you will find in a bag of marbles that come from the dollar store. In any case, I'm not judging. This is a simple machine that can help you sort your marbles quickly and easily.
For every set of marbles, there's going to be an average size. That doesn't mean that one of these marbles is necessarily going to have the average size. It just means that, it means a few things. One thing that it means is that a picture will start to emerge as we put the set through this device. And that picture will start to be a bell curve, or a normal distribution, or a Gaussian distribution. And think of it as like a pile of sand, that the pile of sand will be centered on a particular spot. And so there will be some outliers, as you see when I add marbles, some out here and some out here. And the tolerance, or the width of this bell curve, can be adjusted based on how close these parallel bars are to one another. It's crude at first, but as we approach an infinite number of marbles, the picture will become clearer and clearer, and it will establish itself centered about the average. Now, this average point need not be in the center of one of these cells, it could be off to the side. So the curve isn't going to be perfectly centered with the most of the marbles in one of these cells and an equal number on each side. It's just a model, a mathematical model, that is theoretically perfect, and in practice it will approach that if we keep doing it. If I were to make a crude approximation, I suppose that I would place the average right about there. But not all of the data is in. The more marbles we use, the clearer picture we get. I've only kept this group of marbles, which is closest to the average, and I've discarded all of the rest of them. And the purpose of doing this is to further refine my set. Okay, now using this as my new set, I'm going to turn this set into a normal distribution by making the bars even closer to parallel. I'll leave the top adjustment alone, and I'll bring this adjustment in closer together, and that will spread the distribution out over a wider area, and it will allow me to further refine the size and look for outliers amongst this pile. The adjustment is barely anything at all. I'm just moving them tighter by the smallest amount that's even perceptible to me. And now we'll get a completely different curve. Okay, I don't want to bore you. After this, I'll show you a little bit about how I made this thing, and that'll be it for the probability. But I just want to show you that using a simple instrument, you can really get some incredibly precise results. Now in this new distribution, it looks like the average is somewhere around in here. But we can play this game as many times as we want and further restrict and refine our set as many times as we want until we get a small subset of marbles that are nearly all identical in size. Something like this is very easy to construct, so I would imagine that some of you might want to build it. So let's talk a bit about it. First, I started with a 3/16 beam, but I quickly found that there was too much deflection, meaning that it bends too much, and just a little bit of weight from marbles is enough to bend them apart, and it's barely even noticeable, but the instrument is so precise that little bit of bend actually affects the outcome. I then upgraded to a 1/4-inch rod, but there was still a little bit of bend to it. This final version is a 5/16 zinc-coated rod. They're still only $3, I think, a piece. For metric people, that's something like 5, 6.5, and 8 millimeter. Another thing that really affects the deflection in these beams is the span between the two clamps. So while it might seem convenient to put these clamps all the way, or at least the top clamp, way out of the way up here, it really isn't, because there's much more flexibility now. For the sake of consistency, your tray has to have a stop in it. That way, when you take the tray out to empty it, you put it right back in the same location, because if it's off even a little bit, that totally alters the results. It's also useful to have your catch boxes on somewhat of a slope, and that quickly gets the marbles out of the way. That prevents marbles from jumping cells. Similarly, the nails are in place to heighten the partitions between the cells, and that's because some of the marbles come off spinning with such a force that they'll bounce right into the neighboring cell. This is as simple as it comes on this end. There's just enough room for this to fit in. And on the top end, it's not even fastened. It just slides into place with a friction fit. That gives it the ability to adjust this way, because that affects the overall slope, which I recommend should be somewhere around 1 unit of rise per every 10 units of run, or 1 unit of rise for every 8 units of run, somewhere between those two slopes. And finally, the clamps. I think this is the cool part. Very simple to operate. It's just cork, and they're made from a hardwood, hard maple. This nut knob I've discussed before. You just use a vise to press a smaller nut into a larger nut, and it's a simple and very cost-effective replacement for a wing nut. Well, that's it for now. I certainly hope that you found something here interesting or useful. And if you have any questions or comments, leave them down below. See ya.